Hey everyone, this video I am going to explain you about microservices security patterns and what are the best practices available out there. This will help us a lot when we will be doing actual microservice and securing that one. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started. So the first point comes here is security by designs. So security should start at the moment of designing your software, designing your application. But before looking into that, let's see the what are the top 10 web application security risks. So OWASP is the organization which works towards securing our application and maintains the list, and it publishes that list regularly, and it also tells us what are the options that we can use to secure our application. So let me show you that. So this is the top 10 list of the application security risks. So this is just the overview. I am not going to go into more detail, but just list out that what are those options. So you can go to this link and get the more information about this one. So SQL injection, this is the very common flaw that we all know, that if the SQL queries are not written properly, the inputs are not sanitized properly, they can be exploited by the hackers and they can get access into the system. Okay, so this is the most common and it is the top list. It is at the top from very long time. So here is the point why it is at the top from very long time, because no matter how good and we are doing, there are some flaws, there are some loopholes available in the coding, and also many teams are not following the standard best practices to avoid this exception, avoid this security issue. That is why going through the risk is important, and we should also see how we can avoid this. So if you go to this link here, you can get the more information about this one here, many more information references and how to solve it. All the options are available here. So I am just going to walk you through this list. You go to this link and open it and get the information about it. In subsequent videos, when I am going to do the demo, I'll try my best to follow these standards so that we can avoid these security risks. Okay, so the second point is broken authentication. When session management is not done properly, it can also be exploited by the hackers. And sensitive data exposure, when we are not encrypting data properly from when transferring the data from one service to another service, we can expose the sensitive information about the client, which can be used by the malicious user there, which can be used for all the wrong purposes. And the next is XML, external entities. So it is about the external XML that we use for the configuration, and if it is not done properly, not securely, it can also be exploited by the hackers out there. So broken access control, restriction on what authenticated users allowed to do or often not properly enforced. So that is why I'm going to explain in the further slides here that what are the default policies that we should have to avoid this broken access control here. And the security misconfiguration comes the next point here, and cross-site scripting is there. XSS flaws occur whenever an application includes untrusted data in the new web page without proper validation or escaping. So anything, any object, anything we are creating, that should be sanitized and properly validated. Insecure deserialization, this is also there. So user components with known vulnerabilities. So when we are adding a couple of libraries from the open source system, we should scan those libraries, otherwise they are going to create problem, and sometimes they are also vulnerable and they put our entire application at risk. And insufficient logging and monitoring, so it is very important. So whoever is accessing our application, what they are doing, that should be logged properly, and we should application owner should know that, and that is possible only when we are doing proper logging and monitoring of the application. So coming back to this slide again, security by design. So we all know the SDLC, software development lifecycle. So it starts from this point, requirement analysis, and our actual shape of the application takes place at this point of time, at the time of design. What happens in real life when there is a deadline to complete the project? So what happens, the security which is not a direct part of the feature, it gets missed from the design, and while implementing it is done in haste, it is not properly designed, properly thought about. So it is the very bad practice. Security of the application, thinking about security, so it starts at the very base, which is at the time of designing of the application. Coming to the next one, defense in depth. Let me show you the general application that we have. So we have application, we have any microservice application, right? And that is accessing the data. This is the database part. So this is the at the bottom of the application, at the bottom of the layer is the data, and on top of that we have application. This application is deployed on some machine here and host, and user is accessing that through the internet. So network comes into picture. So you see, at user is accessing this network, so network security must be done properly. Where this application is deployed, that machine should be secured properly. There must be proper firewall, web application firewall, and that should be secured properly. Not any unwanted, unauthenticated access should be there. And at the end, application level security must be there to avoid any security risk, like to avoid any unauthorized access of the application. And data, when we have database installed in the system, that must also be secured separately. The point here is that application security, application developers should not think that the host where application is deployed, that it's secured and we do not have to take care. And data or database team should not think that application is secured, so data is secured. So the responsibility of the each team must be understood properly, and the security in each layer must be taken care properly. So this is the general application. And if I talk about the R microservices architecture here, this is how it goes like. So at the bottom we have data, that must be security of that must be taken care. Microservice security implementation, that is very similar to this application, and host where it is deployed. And when we have this microservices host, microservices that deployed at one machine, microservices get registered itself with the service registry. So that service registry must be secured at the best possible way. And API gateway is something which gives access to the clients, to the user, by which they access our application. So you see, we have couple of more layers here as per the previous one. So at any point of time, API gateway, service registry, host, and all those things, they should be secured separately, not thinking about that others are secured, so I'm secured. Right. So even if it is at the bottom, it is at the mid, there should be security mechanism at each layer. So that is the meaning of the defense in depth. HTTPS, when it comes into picture, so any application that we are developing, they come under client and server architecture. Client is something which users are there, and server where our application is deployed. And when client is sending requests to the server, and server is responding with the response. So whatever data that we are passing here, client is sending and receiving, it is in the network. Okay. And if we are sending some username, password, and any sensitive information, that credit card and all those things, if we are sending that in the plain text. So the best example, that if you connect to any public Wi-Fi when you are on railway station or airport, it gives you the instruction that avoid sending the sensitive information, because you are on the public network and anyone can see that. It is not that easy, but the person who tries to exploit it, if they get access to this network here, they can see the information what you are transmitting through this network. So if they are in plain text, they are very easy to be exploited. But there is a way that we can encrypt this information, that so that we can avoid this kind of loophole, this kind of data exposure. So this is what we call the man in the middle attack, this kind of attack. So to avoid this, we should secure our application. So there is this HTTP, HTTP hypertext transfer protocol. So on which this client is accessing our application. So we should secure our application and run that application on the secured environment. You see the TLS, we have the other term, transport layer security. When we have started our application, we have implemented HTTPS on the server layer, on the application label. So whatever data is transmitted here, it is encrypted, and no other person can see that other than the trusted clients and servers. Okay, so that is the importance of this. This is very much important. All the services must be deployed in HTTPS mode. Okay, coming to the next one, default deny and least privileges. When we are creating any application, there comes two use cases. it is fresh application, new users are coming to access the system, and second is existing user tries to access the system. So what happens here, if any new user is coming to access the system, by default they must be denied. No access should be allowed that. And other thing, if they have registered with the system and they have registered with the system, so at every layer there should be rule defined that what they are allowed to do or not. And by default they should not be allowed to do anything. There should be explicit permission for everything. So they can prevent us a lot from like broken access control system that we saw, the top 10 web application security risk. So by following these one, we can avoid that risk. Dependency scanning. So our application, third-party libraries makes large part of the application. We are creating Spring Boot application. If you see the external dependencies, you can see that how many external libraries we are using there. And transitive dependencies make it more difficult to track the each library that we have. Okay, so transitive dependency means if you are using this L1 library here, and it is further depending on the L2, and L2 is further depending on the L3. So this chain is like large. So to manage and to manually check these dependencies is very difficult, and this is something we have to do, because in these libraries there can be some malfunctioned code which can be exploited by the hackers, and they can get access to the system. So to avoid these ones, so before using any third party application, we should scan those one. So if you are using GitHub, so there is a automated tool, a Dependabot here, which accesses, which scans the every repository, and they give automated report. They also raise the pull request of that one, Dependabot, which you can merge and change that dependency. So, and others are there, Snyk and JFrog, X-Ray are other options that we can use to scan our dependencies. And the next point is slow down attackers. So how we can do this? Apply the complex encryption mechanisms. Rate limiters help us a lot in slowing down attackers, because we can now track how many requests are coming from a specific client, and based on that we can say that only 10 requests are allowed in a day, or 100 requests are allowed in a day. So this can help us, this can highly discourage the user to apply the brute force way to attack the system. And the next, we can say that exponential back off in case of failure. If there are like security breaches, like three attempts are there, so fourth attempt should say that you are allowed only three times, and after that if there is any failed attack, you say that you try after 24 hours. Okay, so this is what exponential back off is there. So first you can say that 1 hour, and if again there is a failure, you can say that try after three times, and again there is there to seven times, and then ultimately you can block that user. So in this way, attackers get very few requests to send to the server. Okay, and this limited number of attempts. So if you see any banking site or any secure site, you see you have limited number of attempts that you can try with the username password. So these are the some way that we can use to slow down the attackers. And access and identity token. So instead of directly passing the username and password to the services, we can make use of the tokens here. So they help us a lot. So we use the auth servers to do that. So how is this applicable here? So there are, so for example, if I take here that we have three services here, and here is the user who is trying to access this one. Okay, so what happens? So auth user will contact the auth server here. This will pass the access token here, and user will then use that token to call the API gateway, and API gateway will contact the auth server here and will validate that token, and if validation is okay, only then it will be allowed to access the services that are there. Okay, so here you see the user is not passing the username password to API gateway, but it is passing the access token that is short-lived, and it can be invalidated at any point of time if it is found that there is security loophole and someone else is trying to access that one. So you see, we have this services secured behind the API gateway and behind the auth server here. So there are two patterns here, many to one and one to one. What I just explained here, that many services are secured using one token only. Okay, so auth server, only one auth server is there. which is securing all of the services using this API gateway. And what happens, like when this auth server is compromised, all of the services are compromised here. So to avoid this, and if use case it's such that we can go to one-to-one, so we can have auth server for service one here, auth server one, and we can have service two, auth server two here, and service three, we can have auth server three here. So what happens here, and for the API gateway, we can have any other auth server here. So now access token will be first access token will allow the API gateway, and when that is passed here, service one will perform another level of authentication and authorization to allow the access to the end user. So this is what one-to-one access is there. So the identity of the requester is securely passed around with the help of tokens. So identity of this user is not directly exposed to these services here, but a token is passed which is verifying that one. So identity of the user is with this auth server here. Okay, coming to the next point. Services can verify whether particular token is authorized to perform the action or not. This we just explained here. And the last point here is sanitize all request parameters. So when binding the user information, any sensitive information, this one example that I have taken. So if you have created the username and password here, so if user is passing that one, we get the object in the Java application here. User which will contain the username password, this is the explicit constructor is here, but there is no validation of this username and password here. That now at this point of time, this username can contain any alphabet, any special character, any numbers here, and password also can contain that. So this way we can have some policy around this one, that username can have a specific length, it can have a specific characters, and it cannot contain special characters here. So all these validations should be implemented at this point of time only, at the time of user creation. So we can prevent lots of attacks at this point only, when we are creating the user object using the username password here. So this is the one example that sanitization I have explained here in user only, but you can think of it while creating the object of any credit card, banking information and all those things. So the predefined policies like length, characters and all those things should be in place. So that's all about this video that I wanted to cover here. So what next we are going to see? So we are covering this microservices project store here, demo video here. So we have created the product microservice here, right? And next we are going to secure these endpoints. And to secure these endpoints, I needed to cover the theory part. So I have covered that. And while covering the architecture theory part, microservices, so this microservices security pattern was missed at that point of time. So this I just covered here, so I'm going to put the link here, this one, and all the demo links are coming here. Okay, so I hope you got some useful information from this video and it helped you in getting the understanding about security patterns. So I'll see in the next video with the user authentication service.